Hello everyone, welcome back to English Paper. My name is Marta and it's been a while since I last filmed. So today we're reviewing Circe, which is a book that I really, really liked. And the first thing that I want to do is rave about the cover because it has such a nice cover. It's not only like the foil in here from the dust jacket, like it's so shiny, like in the back it's like black and stuff. But then if we take the dust jacket off, we have this other foil, just so beautiful. We have like a flowery design in the middle. I don't know, like I really, really like, that was a dust jacket. I really, really like the covers when they have foils or something on them because it just gives them like an oomph instead of being like completely black. So yeah, I really like that cover. Now, I was not expecting this to actually be my first book of the year, especially because it's not something that I would normally just pick up when I'm like, oh, I want a book. The thing is, I thought I would have been reading something Sarah J. Maas, probably A Court of Frost and Starlight, especially because her new book comes out at the end of the month, I think? Middle of February? Not too sure, I need to double check that. But the thing is, for the last year and a half, I have been reading 90% Sarah J. Maas. During my third year of university, I finished the Throne of Glass series and I read her Crescent City. And then during last term, I have read the full ACOTAR series. So basically, when I finished ACOTAR, I was like, I am tired of fantasy, I am tired of fairies, I am tired of this kind of magic. I wanted something different and I did not have any contemporaries at hand. And I looked at my shelves and everything was fantasy and I was like, I don't want something that's fantasy. And then I saw this baby just like staring at me and I was like, that's mythology. Yes, we've got gods, but that's different from fantasy. Let's give it a go. That was probably the best decision I have ever made, because if not, I would have probably gone into a book slump for months and months and months. So for the non-spoilery people, Circe follows the story of Circe. Circe is a goddess. She is the daughter of Helios and it follows her path through mythology. It has excerpts from the Odyssey, but it also has parts with Daedalus. It's actually very, very interesting to see how everything is weaved together. If you have never heard of Circe, you will probably relate her to the witch that lives in an island and transforms men into pigs. The thing that made me put two and two together was when I read that, I just thought of that episode in The Simpsons where they're doing like mythological tales and Homer Simpson is Ulysses. All of his comrades are transformed into pigs and that's where like my light bulb went on and I was like, oh, okay, I know who this person is. But basically, Circe is banished into the island of Aia by the gods because she performed magic. At least that's what they say in this book. I don't know if that's true for the mythology or not. And she is destined to live there for the rest of her days and it basically follows her adventures there, who she meets and her lovers and everything. It's quite interesting. I really enjoyed it. The character development is amazing. So if you have not read it, I do really recommend that you read this book. So now I'm gonna go into a spoilery review of the book. So if you have not read the book, please go read the book and then come back. If not, you're gonna be spoiled. So to start off, I did find the book a bit slow at the start, but that was mainly because we're doing a bit of world building here. We need to know who Circe is and who all these gods are. If you know a little bit about mythology and the Olympians, there's a lot of freaking gods. Especially here, we also mix titans and gods, because technically they live in harmony, but Zeus is still in like power. So basically we need to know who's a titan, who's a god, who has done what, and who is who. So it is a bit slow, especially with all the introductions, and it was a bit confusing at start who was who and who was what, especially because a lot of people have similar names. But then once you get the hang of it, it's actually really, really nice because you have already learned who everyone is, especially because it's important to know who is who around Circe. And if you don't remember who is who, you can go to the beginning and it's like in the first chapter, you know that you're gonna have the explanation of who is who to Circe and why each person is important. I actually also had to Google who the hell Helios was because I thought that the god of the sun was Apollo, but apparently no, the god of the sun is Helios. So yeah, a bit slow, but well explained. I really, really enjoyed this scene where they bring Prometheus in because that is the first time that we actually see Circe apart from the gods and like be different from them. We learn that she is kind of very naive. And I really enjoyed this because throughout the book, there's huge character development for her. I can see the childlike aspects of her personality when we are introduced to Prometheus. Because they bring Prometheus, and now, if you don't know the myth of Prometheus, basically the myth of Prometheus goes that he gave fire to humans, and because of that, he was punished. So we have this scene where Prometheus is brought in to be seen by the gods, and the gods basically give him this punishment. And it's really interesting because the gods just leave him be, and he's tied up in the middle of an empty room. And Circe just goes and says hi to him and asks him if he would like some nectar, to which he answers yes. And it's that act of kindness to help someone in need that I think marks a huge difference between the personality and the character of Circe and the character of every other god in the book. Because she has a moralizing quality, she has a human-like quality, she essentially has a bit of mortality in her, even though she is still immortal. So basically, because of this is the first scene that we see Circe stand out as a different being, even though she is still a god. And she doesn't really understand why she does it, but she does feel like that pull to do it. And it is something that I really, really enjoy because it just marks her path for the rest of the book and her rest of the character development that she goes through. So the next thing that stands out for me in Circe's story is when she meets Glaucus. Basically, she keeps visiting this island, and one day she bumps into a human fisherman whose name is Glaucus, and she essentially falls in love with him. Now, because he is immortal, they cannot be together, so she finds out that there are these flowers that will give whoever consumes them their true form, and she figures out how to use these flowers, and Glaucus transforms into a god. Now, Glaucus is not in love with her. He falls in love, or wants to marry. I don't know if he's actually in love with her because we never do see from his point of view, but he wants to marry the other nymph. Another nymph. I cannot say the word nymph. This is so freaking hard. Oh my god. Another nymph who is named Scylla. Now, out of jealousy, Circe turns Scylla into a multi-headed monster with tentacles for legs, and she goes away and sets up in her own island. And what I like about this little story is that firstly, that this is what gets Circe exiled, because she admits to doing this to Glaucus and to Scylla, and all the gods say that she has done this on purpose. She knows that she was a witch, and because she performed witchcraft on purpose to harm the gods, she must be exiled as to not be a threat against Zeus. Whereas the other children that Helios has with Circe's mother, like her other three siblings, are fine to have their own kingdoms and their own lives because they didn't use their powers against the gods. So this is what basically sends Circe to the island of Aia, and it's also like the first step into what will be the rest of her life. She's now a witch. She knows that she's a witch, and basically she will spend the rest of her life in that island learning witchcraft and honing her witchcraft abilities. The first person that ever actually visited Circe in the island is Hermes, but they only have like a sexual relationship. She doesn't really enjoy his company that much. It's just basically for the physical thing and for her to have some sort of company in some way, because obviously she is lonely. If she's not with Hermes, she is doing like all her witchcraft. But the first actual person that changes her, that actually visits her, is Daedalus. Now, Daedalus is, I wouldn't say scientist. He builds things, he constructs things, he has a brilliant mind basically. According to this, he's the one that made the labyrinth for the Minotaur. He also lived within the labyrinth, and his son was Icarus. So yeah, Daedalus goes visit Circe because Circe's sister is gonna give birth, and she's not able to give birth. And even though Circe has no idea how to do this, apparently she is the only one that can help her sister, because one, she is the only witch, and two, she's probably the only one that's gonna care about her sister, which she actually does, because she we have established already, she's a caring person as opposed to the rest of the gods. So she goes and visits her sister, and her sister gives birth to the Minotaur because she actually had sex with a bull. So we have the Minotaur now. Now it's important to note, the sister, we know that she has been married off to someone important. I don't know if it was a prince or something like that, in an island in Greece. I don't remember all the names because literally it will be impossible for me to remember every single name of every single island that is mentioned. So Circe helps give birth to the Minotaur, and they find a place to put it until it's grown, and then Daedalus finds a way to like keep it trapped. And in this short period of time where Circe is allowed to be outside of Aia because the god let her leave the island to help her sister, she falls in love with Daedalus, and they have a very nifty short love story which quite changes Circe a lot. She learns to appreciate humans even more. She gets over her hurt with Glaucus, and she will now miss Daedalus for a long time. She ends up like thinking about him a lot of the time, and he builds her a big loom. And basically I think that a loom is used to make fabrics. So that loom is something that stands in her house and helps her make another things and helps her actually be entertained. And she says that it lasts for centuries, so it was a really damn good loon. And after visiting her sister, she goes back to her island and is basically alone for a long, long while. So one of the people that actually visits her as well is Ulysses. He is from the Odyssey, if you have never heard about him, which I doubt you haven't. And I'm just gonna call him Ulysses instead of Odysseus as they do in the book, because I cannot pronounce that for the best of me, and Ulysses is just a lot easier. So she gets visited by Ulysses, and basically she turns all of his men into pigs, and he basically talks to her and they have a very interesting and deep conversation. And he's like, can you please turn my men back into men and not leave them as pigs? And after this, basically, they have a love story, and he stays there for about a year, because Circe's like, that's not a good time for you to leave. You can stay like a couple of months. Yeah, I can stay like a couple of months. And they basically like keep like making the period longer and longer and longer until Ulysses is there for a year. But then Circe has a vision, if I am correct, or no. Circe has a vision, and Ulysses has to go and see Hades, I think. Oh god, I just read this and I forgot it already. I need to start taking notes while I read the books instead of after. So basically, he is told a prophecy that he needs to leave the island and continue with his journey. He ends up traveling and getting distracted for another 7 years until he finally reaches Ithaca. But by the time that he is leaving, Circe decides that she wants to get pregnant. So she stops taking the elixir, like her anti-baby elixir, and she gets pregnant with Ulysses, and Ulysses never knows that she's actually pregnant. So from that, Telegonus is born. In the mythology, Circe actually has three children, but here she only has one. And I think it's because the other two aren't as important, but Telegonus is fated to kill his dad, basically to kill Ulysses. Basically, she has a very complicated birth, which I am not gonna go into because it was quite traumatic to read. Like, makes me realize like how well written this book is, because it takes quite a bit to like make me traumatized, especially when reading. And then we go through the motherhood period, and that goes quite fast until he's about like 16 or so, and that's when like things start to slow down a bit. She has a terrible motherhood. Her child will not sleep, it will not eat, it just cries and cries and cries and cries, and she's just like basically complaining that he's crying, like, I love my child so much, but will you please stop crying? Thanks God I'm a goddess, because if I wasn't a goddess, I would need to sleep and eat. And I don't know how any human like goes through this and actually comes out alive. And basically, the kid grows up
And he ends up wanting to leave. He grows up on the stories of his father, and he bumps into Hermes. Well, no, he doesn't bump into Hermes. Hermes basically comes and visits him and starts talking to him. He builds a boat and he tells his mom, "Mom, I'm gonna go to Ithaca. I'm gonna visit my father and I want to meet him." And she's very worried about it, but then she realizes that she cannot have her child basically enclosed in an island because he deserves freedom. He is a human because he was born from a human, and even though he might be a half god, he will die and he cannot live all his life enclosed with his mother in an island where she basically practices witchcraft. She also knows that the child cannot hone witchcraft. He doesn't have an ability for it. So she decides to visit the sea god, who is basically like a gigantic stingray. And the sea god tells her, "You have to touch the something that will basically paralyze you and kill you, because it even has the power to give great pain to the gods." And it's basically like the end of his tail. "If you touch that, I will give it to you." So she goes to touch it and the god was like, "You're brave enough to touch it. You deserve it." Like, that's a classical trope. So he gives her the end of his tail, like the knife venom thing. And she makes a spear out of that and gives it to her son. And basically after that, Telegonus basically goes to Ithaca. He tells us, like, when he's telling his mother, that he met Penelope. Penelope was Ulysses' wife, and he met Telemachus, which is Ulysses' son, who is now 30 or 30 something he should be. And he accidentally killed Ulysses because Ulysses has gone mad, because he, like, Athena was his patron, and Athena basically kept whispering that he needs to go on to an adventure and yada 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 yada. Yeah. And he goes to attack Telegonus, and Telegonus accidentally, like, scratches him with the end of a spear, and Ulysses immediately dies. So we have the situation where now Circe has Penelope, Telemachus, and Telegonus in her island, because Penelope has insisted that they have to go to her island, and she doesn't know why, but she's suspicious because Ulysses kept telling her that Penelope was very, very, very smart, and everyone tells her that she doesn't do a step if she doesn't know what's going to happen next. We have this situation where she's very suspicious of Penelope, and I love that because of all the experience that she has had with her sister, with Daedalus, with Ulysses. She has learned how people work. She has learned that the gods are not merciful, that people have hidden meanings. She has learned a lot about Penelope because Ulysses told her a lot of stories about Penelope. So basically, she's wondering why the hell Penelope is there. She's rightly so not trusting of Penelope, because we learn that she has actually come to the island instead of going back to her family, because Athena is pursuing Telemachus to basically be her patron, as the same as she was the patron with Ulysses, and she doesn't want that, and Telemachus doesn't want that either. Basically, they have gone to Circe's island because it is protected against the gods. And we know this because when Telegonus was born, Athena tried to kill him, because there was a prophecy that Telegonus would kill Ulysses, and that happened, and she didn't want that to come to happen. So Circe protected the island, and it is still protected against all the gods. But Circe ends up having to break the spell because she is basically making all the gods very angry. So she breaks the spell, and Athena comes 3 days later after Circe has given them time by telling the gods that it's gonna take 3 days to break the spell. So Penelope and Telemachus have had time to talk, and Circe thinks that Telemachus will go with Athena. Athena comes and she tells Telemachus, "Will you come with me? I'm gonna take you to faraway lands. You're gonna be the conqueror of these lands, and you're gonna have riches and blah 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 blah." And Telemachus is like, "Nope, no thank you. I do not seek adventure. I don't want to be my like my father. I have nothing in common with him. He went crazy. Bye bye." So you can see the fear start in Circe, because Athena then goes to her son, to Telegonus, and she's like, well, would you like to come? Because you're also the son of Ulysses, and Telegonus actually wants to go, and Circe is forced to actually let him go because she doesn't want to make the gods angry. Basically, she ends up being like, okay, he will go, but break my exile. And the gods finally break her exile, and she lets Telegonus go. And that brings us on to the ending. I really, really, really enjoyed the ending. Mostly because I was not expecting her to turn human. I was expecting her to fall in love with Telemachus. I was expecting that to happen, them to end up together. But I think the fact that she ends up being human is like the perfect ending for her, because she finally belongs into a world where she actually belongs. She has been being a god for all her life in a world where she doesn't feel accepted, where she has been exiled, where she, like, all her family don't appreciate her, everyone hates each other, everyone wants to be more than each other, and she's not like that. She has morals, she is human, she hurts, she falls in love, and basically, after all the hurt that she has gone through, after being exiled, after falling in love with Daedalus and him dying because he's mortal, after Ulysses dying, after all the shenanigans with her son, she finally gets what she deserves, which is her compensation. She gets free from Aia to travel the world, and she goes to the place where the flowers she gave Glaucus are, and she makes herself a potion, and she's like, I hope that this works. And it does work. We know that it works, because even though it's very well written, because it's a scene where she tells us what will happen in the future, but she basically ends the book by like Circe actually drinking the potion. She will have children with Telemachus, and she will travel the world and see her son be an emperor and see her grandchildren. And I think it's the best ending that she could have had. It's what she wanted, what she had always wanted, to be human, and she doesn't have to be alone anymore. So those are all my thoughts about Circe. I really, really enjoyed the book. I thought it was very well written, very well constructed. It's something that actually did take me out of a book slump or an impending book slump, which is always appreciated. And I think I give it 4.9 stars out of 5. Not the 5 out of 5, because one, I don't think I ever give a book 5 out of 5 stars, even if it's like a Sandra Clare book. And secondly, because like at the start it did go a bit slow for my liking. But yeah, 4.9 stars out of 5. If you like this video, please don't forget to give it a thumbs up, subscribe if you want more, and don't forget to hit the notification bell so that you never miss any content. My name is Marta, it was great to have you all here. See you later. Bye!